Hello, and welcome to Advising for Future Ready Careers. My name is Kelsey Kamen. I am the Program Manager for Counselors for Computing. It's my pleasure to bring you the 19th webinar in this series, hosted by NCWIT Counselors for Computing. Each month, we connect you with thought leaders at the cutting edge of technology, and the series offers a unique opportunity for us to dive into the intersection of computer science with traditional and non-traditional STEM fields, also known as CS+X. Throughout the presentation, we would love for you to submit your questions through the Q&A feature on the toolbar at the bottom of your screen. And we will also be sharing resources in the chat, which can also be found at the bottom of your toolbar, I would like to welcome our host, Dr. Christina Green. Great. Hello. I'll hand it off to you.
Yes, thank you. Hello, I'm Dr. Christina Green, and I'm a school counselor and also a school counselor professor and leader in Pennsylvania and a computer science enthusiast as well. The National Center for Women in Information Technology is a nonprofit community of more than 1,500 universities, companies, nonprofits, and government organizations nationwide. NCWIT equips change leaders with resources for taking action in recruiting, advancing women across the entire computer ecosystem. Before NCWIT, programs focusing on women in computing existed mostly in isolation. Without the benefit of shared best practices, effective resources, communication with others, or national reach. Today, these programs are part of NCWIT's community, creating a great far impact than if institutions were just acting alone. Counseling for Computing, also known as C4C, is one of the programs in the NCWIT's K-12 Alliance. The NCWIT Counselors for Computing C4C program provides information and resources that help counselors join the front line of computing conversations. We bring people and programs together with professional development, knowledge, and resources to give all students access to transformative computing careers. We wouldn't be here today without the support of our sponsor, the Department of Defense, DOD STEM, the largest employer of scientists and engineers in the nation. DOD STEM offers educational programs, internships, and scholarships for students and many career development opportunities for educators. We share their website in the chat for you so you can take a look when you have additional time. Now, I would like to introduce our speaker for this evening, Pauline Lake. Pauline Lake is the Curriculum and Professional Development Coordinator for the National Center for Computer Science Education. She works with the Mobile CSP and CSAwesome programs, serves on the Coaching for Equality and CS project team, and is an adjunct faculty for the CS Educator Workshops at St. Scholastica. As an undergrad, Pauline double majored in computer science and educational studies and later earned her master's in public policy with a concentration in educational policy. She is currently working towards the completion of a certificate in project management. As a biracial cisgender female, Pauline is passionate about providing equitable opportunities for historically marginalized students in both formal and informal settings through curriculum, internships, after-school programs, et cetera. Pauline has also served as a mentor for computer science students in various capacities. Thank you for joining us, Pauline.
Thank you, Dr. Green. And I realized there that I did not update everyone about my introduction there, but I recently just had a title change. So talking about progressing in career, I am now a professional learning manager for the National Center for Computer Science Education. So taking the next step in my career with the center. I'm excited to be here and share a little bit about my journey and how I got into computer science, but to also share resources with you and how you can get involved with free resources for learning computer science, and hopefully be well on your journey if you're a student or if you're an educator, be able to take the information back to your students in the classroom. I'm going to share my screen. Okay, hopefully everybody can see my screen okay. Perfect. All right. So I want to start by just sharing a little bit about the National Center for Computer Science Education. At the center, which is how I refer to it, we champion research and provide equitable computer science learning opportunities for K through 16 teachers and students across the nation and even internationally. Many of our projects are National Science Foundation grant-funded projects, and you can see on the right-hand side here, I've highlighted a few of the projects that I currently work on, including Coaching for Equity in CS, which is helping teachers across the nation improve their computer science teaching and learning about strategies to support diverse learners in the classroom, including female students, English language learners, and students with disabilities. We are also the home of Mobile Computer Science Principles and CSAwesome, as Dr. Green mentioned in my introduction. These are both two free ebooks that are available online that will help you learn computer science through interactive electronic textbooks on Runestone Academy. And I'm going to share those with you in just a bit, but I wanted to give you just a sense of what the National Center for Computer Science Education is and how we are working to provide these opportunities to teachers and students to invite everyone to have an opportunity to learn computer science. So most of what I'm going to share today about my experience is really due to one project that I began working on as an undergrad that turned into a national program, which is Mobile CSP. And I want to give you some background so you have some frame of reference as I share my journey and career. So Mobile CSP is currently an endorsed provider for the Computer Science Principles course for advanced placement. CSP was the largest advanced placement course launch in history in 2016. Our version of Computer Science Principles focuses on learning computer science through the lens of mobile computing and building socially useful mobile apps for your smartphone. When I began Mobile CSP and working with building apps, it was only available for Android, and it's so exciting to know now that the tool is also available for building iOS apps as well. And in Mobile CSP, we're focusing on not only building mobile apps, but building apps that are socially useful, helping to solve a problem or challenge that might be affecting us in our communities, impacting our families and friends. And it also is based around collaboration and being creative with our classmates and whoever we're working with, but also working on learning and improving writing and communication. There's a huge project-based focus in Mobile CSP as students are working together to build mobile apps that are for them. You can visit our website at mobilecsp.org, and I'll also share a little bit more in just a bit. So, to sum up my journey, I think I would say that I would say my piece of advice to those watching this, especially if you are a young computer science student or aspiring to be a computer science student, is to take advantage of the opportunities or CS opportunities that are presented to you. This could be from your family, your friends, your teachers, your counselors, but I want to share how I got here to where I am, which involved taking advantage of opportunities that were presented to me. So in 2008, I was a junior at a high school in Chicago, and I remember my school guidance counselor had given me information about an interview that was taking place. I had no idea what the interview was about, other than it was potentially to earn a scholarship for college. I did not have any information, but as it turns out, that interview was the first of three for a series of interviews with the Posse Foundation, which sends students in groups of 10 to 12 to colleges together as a support system. So I want to give a shout out to my counselor, Mrs. Edwards, for sharing that opportunity with me. And I took full advantage of that opportunity, not knowing what I was getting myself into. And I ended up being accepted to receive the Posse Scholarship and was accepted into Trinity College in Hartford, Connecticut, as part of Trinity Posse One Chicago. So shout out to my Posse mates as well. When I arrived in Hartford in 2009, it was a small college I was going to. I knew I had some sense of education was my focus. I was thinking maybe I wanted to do math and teaching. I had no idea at the time that I wanted to do computer science. It wasn't until the summer of 2010 where I found an offer for a summer internship in a newsletter for undergrads. And it said, essentially, if you like to use technology and you like trying things out and you would like a summer stipend and housing, like all of the wonderful things that come with a summer internship, to come and interview. And as it turns out, I walked into the interview not knowing, again, what I was getting myself into, just that it was an opportunity that maybe sounded like it could be a good fit for me. And I ended up walking out with an internship with the HFOS, Humanitarian Free and Open Source Software Foundation. And it was in that summer internship where I started testing out MIT App Inventor, and that internship eventually led to the Mobile CSP project coming about. So when I tell this story, I say it's about taking advantage of the opportunities that came about. Again, I kind of stumbled upon computer science with this internship. But I also say to folks that essentially the red carpet was laid out for me, and all I had to do was take advantage of the opportunities that were being shared with me and show up, be present, be myself, and to pursue what was given. And it was my choice whether or not I wanted to actually be there and try to take advantage of the opportunity. So again, take advantage of the opportunities that come to you, because you never know what could happen. So if you fast forward now, I'm doing my math correctly, I think I'm 13 years into working with the Mobile Computer Science Principles Project, and it all started with a summer internship. I wanted here to highlight some of the projects that I've worked on, and I gave a shout out to some of the folks that have been a part of my career and journey. But some of the projects that I have worked on started with Work It Off was a mobile application that I built with my classmates and colleague as part of the summer internship that I had. That was part of Michelle Obama's Apps for Healthy Kids contest, and we won the $10,000 student award, which was a national competition. So I went in not really knowing anything about computer science, again, just looking to have fun with technology and experience a summer internship, and it turned into winning a really huge competition. And that sparked my interest in computer science. I went on to start a summer and after school program for high school students, teaching them, giving back, taking on the education side that I knew I always wanted to pursue. And I decided to help students learn computer science, and was doing after-school programs and summer programs, teaching them how to build their own mobile apps. So kind of sharing and passing on the knowledge that I had learned. Again, that turned into the Mobile CSP project, which I then also led the Mobile CSP App Expo, which is an annual event for high schoolers who are building apps in the Mobile CSP project to move have the opportunity to move on and show others and their peers and their family and friends the apps that they've been making in the class. I then went on and started the Mobile Apps for Hartford summer internship. So I had the opportunity to also give back. I had the opportunity to select some of the students that were in the Mobile CSP course in the Hartford area and give them a summer internship of their own that they could learn computer science on another level and take with them. And again, that led into also working with CSAwesome, the AP CSA course, and coaching for equity. So these are some of the projects. Again, Mobile CSP sort of was the start, and building mobile apps was my start in computer science education. I've talked a little bit about these already. We have Mobile Computer Science Principles, which uses MIT's App Inventor. It's a blocks-based programming language, and that's the one that I'm going to show you today. And our ebook is available for free on Runestone Academy again. We also have, as I mentioned, CSAwesome, which is AP Computer Science A for learning Java programming. That's available on csawesome.org. And we also have the free ebook available for that as well. So again, both of these are College Board endorsed curricula, and we also provide professional development for teachers, as well as the free ebook on Runestone Academy. And if you're unfamiliar with advanced placement, you should know that students can essentially take the courses and earn college credit for taking them at the end of the course. They take the exam and they can go on and use that credit at accepted institutions across the nation. So Runestone Academy, which I keep mentioning, is a free ebook platform. And you can track your progress in learning computer science on the platform. There's many different open source and free electronic books available besides Mobile CSP and CSAwesome. So I highly recommend that you check out the website, check out the different ebooks. Once you register and log in, completely free to do, you can save your progress on the work that you're doing. It is really interactive and it allows you to learn either at your own pace going through the different ebooks that are available, or you may be working with a teacher or instructor that is using the ebook in their classroom and you're monitoring your progress with them helping you in the background. So students can complete what's inside the ebook, the different challenges, interact with the essentially the code and the self-check questions that are there as they're learning computer science. Their teachers and instructors can see the progress in the background in the dashboard that is available in Runestone, where they can also create assignments that help guide the students in their learning. And also there are many different grading capabilities available. Some of those grading options that happen with questions, those are auto-graded. So you have the ability to kind of hit submit and immediately it will give you feedback on whether or not you're correct. And so that can really be helpful in your CS journey if you are working online on your own or with limited help. It's really nice, in my opinion, to get the immediate feedback of whether or not you're doing well in answering the questions, or if maybe there's a misconception that you are having, it will correct, like kind of give you the guidance and the correction to be able to move forward. So really, really awesome free tool that you can use. Again, many different ebooks, and we're going to take a look at Mobile CSP's ebook tonight. I'm putting the slide back up here because I just want to emphasize, and especially if someone was joining us late, again, that Mobile CSP is about learning computer science, an intro to computer science and computer science principles through the lens of mobile computing and building mobile applications for your phone. Essentially, we ask students or challenge students to build socially useful apps, not just games, that are solving a problem or challenge that's being faced in their community. So here I wanted to show again that Mobile CSP is a complete curriculum. There is our blue side on the left here, which I will show momentarily. On the blue side, the Mobile CSP student ebook is completely free on Runestone, has all of the student lessons built out. Students can go through one by one and progress through the complete book, which has at this time, I believe, 9 units in total. Some of them are a little bit more introductory than others as you progress through. And then on the right hand side here in the green, I'm showing Teach Mobile CSP. So if you are an instructor, an educator, a counselor, and you're looking for providing support to a student who might be using the ebook, you can use the Teach Mobile CSP ebook, which is the companion that has all of the lesson plans. So there's a complete set of lesson plans and curricular materials that can be used alongside the ebook that will allow you to help and assist students as they're learning and using the student ebook. And I believe we'll be able to put some of the links in the chat as well. So I wanted to show everyone sort of what these, what a sample lesson would look like. So again, we have the student side, which is the blue toolbar, the blue bar, the blue logo. And then at the top, we have the green logo, which is the student lesson for the teachers. So one of the very first apps in Mobile CSP is actually called I Have a Dream, where students are looking at a very important part of American history that involves Dr. Martin Luther King and Malcolm X. And essentially when students are building out the app that's in this lesson, they are having a button on the screen that has a picture of MLK and or Malcolm X. And when you press the button, it plays the famous I Have a Dream speech for Martin Luther King. And then when you go on and build out the app a little bit more, it has Malcolm X, one of his famous speeches that plays as well. So I'm going to just kind of exit out here for a second and see if I can share the ebook. Hopefully you can still see my screen, okay. So this is the blue side. I mentioned the student side, and this is what it looks like when you are looking at 2.2, I Have a Dream. There is a navigation bar that you can go to this chapter and you can navigate to other lessons, but definitely we would recommend going sequentially. And this just happens to be the very first app that is built. So there's a time estimate of 45 minutes. You can read through the kind of introduction, which explains what I just said about what this app is intended to do. There are learning objectives. There's a preview video so you can see the app in progress. You'll notice that there is a vocabulary that is highlighted. You can even hover over the vocabulary and it will give you the vocabulary word and it will give you the definition right in the browser. There's also a learning activities section. So in every page in Mobile CSP, the learning activities section differs slightly. It depends on really what the purpose of the lesson is, but there's a variety of activities. So you may find that there's a video that you need to watch. There could be a worksheet that you need to complete. It could be a PowerPoint presentation or a slide, Google Slide is usually what we use. There's also a tutorial. So in this case, there's a tutorial to show you how to build the mobile app. And it tells you kind of step by step, do this step and then do this step. And then it walks you through step by step how to build this mobile app inside MIT App Inventor. And there's a text version. So if you're someone who is really just prefers to read through the text and kind of go at your own pace, you can do that. But there's also a video tutorial that you can watch. So myself, I might, you know, have two browsers open, one where the video is showing on one side of my screen and one where the App Inventor platform or App Inventor in programming environment is open. And I can kind of build as I'm watching the video and being guided through how to run how to set up the app. With running the app, the really cool thing is that MIT App Inventor can actually run on your device. So I'm an Android user, I have my own Android phone, and I can take my app that I build in MIT App Inventor and I can connect that to my device and I can run it through a Wi-Fi connection or I can install the app and kind of take the app with me when I'm done with it. I can also use what's called an emulator. So you'll see in the video preview here, there's an emulator that is used sort of like a mock phone on your screen that is used on the computer, and you can test the app right there on your computer, kind of side by side as you're building it out without having a device at all. So if you don't have your own device, that's not a problem. You can use the emulator to test your apps. So again, there's a tutorial, more instructions, giving more vocabulary and terminology. This one's a pretty short one. It's very focused on learning and being introduced to the MIT App Inventor environment. You also have the summary that happens. We make sure we connect all of this again back to the computer science principles framework for the College Board so students can prepare for that AP exam at the end of the year. We provide some still curious sections where students can maybe dive a little bit deeper if they want to go beyond what the lesson is asking them to do. But the part that I like most probably is this part here, which is the self-check, where you can go in and you can interact again with the vocabulary. You can try to do a little kind of quiz of yourself to see, do I know this word or do I need to work on studying it a little bit more? But then there's also these sort of immediate feedback questions where there's might be multiple choice questions, for example, where you can select an answer and you would say, check me, and it will tell you immediately if you are right or wrong. And if you are using this in a class with other students, say your teacher has set it up, you can get a comparison to see how are you doing compared to the rest of the class with understanding. So let's see if I can get what type of output does this generate? Well, when you click the button, you're going to play a sound. So I'm going to do A, check me, and it tells me, yes, it's a green check mark that you're right. And some of these, as you progress, you get a little bit more detailed feedback where it might tell you maybe why you might be close, but not quite right. And maybe you can try again. You can unlimited tries. You can keep trying and trying until you get it right, and it will give you the feedback. As you can see, there's different types of questions that you can interact with as you go through. And let's see, here's one here. So this is like a Blockly, Quizly type question where it takes a replication of the MIT App Inventor environment. And you can actually program this. So you want to say to pause. So if I click over here, I see all the different blocks, which are the same ones that would be an MIT App Inventor if I was programming right now. In this one, I want to be able to have the button click pause the player. So I'm going to go to player, pause player one, and I would connect my blocks. And if we were an App Inventor and connected to the emulator or connected to my phone, I could run and test this. But it's nice here just as a little quiz to see if you're understanding the concepts. And so in this case, I was correct. It tells me good, your solution is correct. If you were incorrect, it would give you maybe some test cases of things that you could look at to check your understanding. So there's a few of those. And then every single Mobile CSP lesson is going to end with a portfolio reflection. So this is where we ask the students and the teachers to keep a Google site portfolio, or Google Docs are also used, which is sort of a documentation of their learning as they're going through. So in addition to the ebook, they also have these documents where they take the reflection questions and they reflect and think about what have they been learning in this lesson, and can they apply their knowledge that they're learning to answer the questions that are posed here. And then they keep track of that in their portfolio. At the end of the ebook or the course, you would have a complete portfolio that you could take with you as documentation of all of your work that you've done. You could share it with family, friends. I've had students in the past have also shared it with future employers to show the work that they had been doing in Mobile CSP. So this is an example of what the student lesson would look like. If we were going to take a look at the student lesson plan, I realize I did not open this up. So I'm going to do that now just to show you sort of how it looks almost the same. What you're seeing here is I'm logged in and I have many different ebooks and courses that I'm a part of. I want to go to teach mobile CSP. If you're new, you probably won't have that many listed. Might have just a couple, but hopefully we can share in the chat the link to the teach mobile CSP site. So this is the educator side, and you can see that there's a whole list here for every lesson. There's a lesson plan. So we were just in 2.2, I Have a Dream. Again, it looks almost the same, except there's a green logo at the top. And this is the lesson plan. So this has a link to the student lesson, explains what it is the students will be working on. It has the framework for them and the skills. It has a little bit of professional development for the educator that's trying to assist the student, tells you what materials you would need, and then a complete lesson plan with all of the learning activities that you could follow to share this lesson in the classroom with students. We've had this used as a full complete course, a half year course, but also used in many clubs and after school programs as well. So different places that you can use those. And then there's a reflection for the teacher. So that kind of shows you what a student lesson looks like and what a teacher lesson plan or student lesson plan looks like. The only thing I'm not showing here today is the MIT App Inventor platform. You got a kind of preview of what it looks like, but I want to show you over here, again, what this looks like when you program it out. So if we were following the lesson, the tutorial from start to finish, you would have built out a design of the user interface, what the app would look like when you are using it on your device. And then on the back end, you would have built out the code. And in this case, this is an example of the code of when you click one of the buttons, like the Malcolm button, so they can read this from left to right. When you click Malcolm, when Malcolm button click, you are going to call MLK player pause. So if the MLK speech was playing, you would pause it. And then if the Malcolm player, Malcolm speech is playing, you would pause it. Otherwise, when you click it, it would start to play. So this kind of shows and starts to see the logic that's happening behind a button click, right? Just a very simple, we refer to it as a simple button click, but there's a lot of logic that's happening behind it with if statements and event handlers is what they're called. So you can see here the user interface and the coding of the blocks. Also wanted to share this graduate credit for educators. So that kind of there shows you how Mobile CSP is available as an ebook. Again, we have CSAwesome is available as an ebook for learning Java as well. But for teachers and educators, we have this certificate in computer science education at the center, and there are education workshops that you can complete. There's a series of four of them, and if you complete all four, you can earn the certificate in computer science education. And if you take Mobile CSP or CSAwesome professional development, which we offer typically in the summer, you can then go on to teach. If you go on to teach those courses or use them in some capacity, you can apply for the EDU workshops, and those count towards the certificate. So we've had teachers who've done both Mobile CSP and CSAwesome. They've done the PD for both of those and then done the education workshops. And by the time they're done with that, they're halfway done with their certificate in computer science education. This is offered through the College of St. Scholastica, where the National Center for CS Education is housed, which is known for its online education programs. So all of this is completely online. You can be anywhere in the US and be able to work towards your certificate in computer science education. We also have CS conferences. So two of the big ones that are coming up, if you are not aware, we have the Pathfinders Online Institute, a great opportunity for public US teachers through generous funding through the Emphasis Foundation USA to take courses this summer. I believe the deadline is coming up. It might be a rolling deadline depending on which PD you're signing up for, but there's 20 different courses this summer and you can sign up for two of them. So you would be able to sign up for those courses, take them at no cost to you, and continue on with your computer science and maker education journey in that way. But another one that's highly recommended that a lot of CS educators are talking about and always have a blast is the CSTA annual conference. So csteachers.org is another resource that you can use. And the annual conference this year is virtual. I think they're alternating, but every other year they meet in person versus virtual. And usually I am there. So if you happen to go to a CSCA annual conference in person, look for me, say hello. I'd love to chat with you and talk more if you would like. And I think that is it. I don't know if there are specific questions that came in.
Yes, we actually do have a few questions for you, Pauline. And thank you so much for that wonderful presentation. So the first one for this evening is that our participants love the accessibility of the eBooks and wanted to know, have you seen a lot of success with them? And then how do you collect data on their impact?
Okay, I might need a reminder about the second one in just a moment, the second part of the question. But the first part of the question, accessibility, I think that depends how you're measuring success depends on what are you looking at, because accessibility could be viewed in many different ways. The Runestone Academy is not managed, we're not managers of it. It's managed by its own team, a great team, including Bradley Miller, who helps. And they're very, very open to any time that features are suggested or needed. They definitely look into trying to accommodate those. I think for Mobile CSP and CSAwesome in particular, the accessibility comes down to, you know, how much are we using videos versus text that might be showing up, and whether or not there are screen readers that are carefully able to view those. But I think just in general, accessibility from just being access, right? I think the fact that these are free eBooks, that is really important as well, to put those in the hands of students and teachers who may not have access to expensive textbooks that are physical textbooks. I think the ease of being able to take them with them wherever they may be, use them on a Chromebook, a laptop, or even on your phone. You can go on your phone. If a student has a phone, they can log in and still, you know, if they have to take a subway train, like I had to for high school, you could be on the train ride and on your phone and learning as you're going. So accessible in that sense is working. I will take a moment to acknowledge that the National Center for Computer Science Education is a part of the Access CS for All group, which is looking at making blocks-based languages more accessible, especially for students who might be visually impaired. I know Mobile CSP, which I just shared, you can see is the blocks-based programming language, and that is definitely a challenge, and we acknowledge that for students who are visually impaired. We are currently a part of the Access CS for All group, which is looking into kind of making an opportunity in another programming language, another environment that will be accessible for those who are visually impaired. So I think it just, again, it depends on what angle you're looking at and who are you looking at it being successful for. And if Dr. Green, can you remind me of the second part of the question? Because I knew I was going to forget that.
Absolutely. A very, very important topic for educators and school counselors is about collecting data. What have you found in the collected data in regard to the impact of the e-books?
I think that this definitely maybe pulls out maybe a challenge. We've done a lot of National Science Foundation projects, research projects, but we haven't necessarily looked at the data specifically that's in the ebook. So I mentioned probably very briefly that Runestone Academy has an instructor dashboard where teachers can have students sign up and monitor their progress. There is an abundance of data that is there, and that could be a project in and of itself to look at how students are performing in all of those, they're called custom ebooks that are created. In our research projects, we're looking at the impact sort of for students kind of indirectly through the eyes of their teachers. So with CSAwesome, we have a National Science Foundation grant that's focusing on teachers who are transitioning from teaching CSP to teaching CSA. And we're asking them through surveys and interviews about how are they using the ebooks in the classroom and what impact are they seeing with their students. I don't have off the top of my head any summaries we could share, but we definitely have some of the reports shared up on csawesome.org under the impact section, if that helps, if folks want to dive a little bit deeper into the reports that have been released from our NSF grants. And I know we will be sharing more. I think it's a challenge for me to answer because there's so much data that is available, and we've looked at it from both a teacher standpoint, using surveys and interviews, versus what is happening on the back end of Runestone Academy with all of the student data and their progress in the ebooks. That would be slightly different, and that's not something that we've tackled per se.
Okay, thank you very much for that answer. Okay, we have another question. And are the ebooks only for computer science teachers, or are the curricula able to be adapted for other courses to include computer science skills?
I will reiterate that there is a huge library on Runestone Academy. You can go on, and I encourage you to go on to check out all of the various ebooks that are available for free, including Mobile CSP and CSAwesome. Teachers can go in and use those ebooks to teach a full course. So if you choose Mobile CSP, for example, you could choose to teach that as a full course, standalone course, or you could use bits and pieces of it and integrate it into an existing course. I said we've also had teachers and students who have used this as part of after school programs and clubs. So it is completely possible to take bits and pieces and just certain lessons that are there, certain activities, and use them where you see fit. I could see, for an example, a math teacher who might want to integrate a couple of the lessons that we have in their math course, for example. So it really depends. You could do both. You could do standalone or integrated and teaching just bits and pieces of the course.
Okay, so there's actually a second part to this question. Do you have any suggestions on how an ELA teacher or a counselor might use these books?
ELA. I'm not sure about ELA at the moment. I might need to think about that a little. Immediately, I would think counselors, you know, if there's a counselor watching this and is interested in learning more, to take a look, go through some of the sample lessons. I think the more that counselors are going through the lessons themselves and understanding what it takes to understand computer science and experiencing it for themselves, then they have a better understanding and a firsthand experience that they can take and explain to the students that they might be recruiting into the classrooms. I think it's very hard to recruit students into courses that you have no idea what it is that they would actually be doing. So if you get to go through even and try just one or two of the lessons, and maybe you don't complete the whole ebook, just one or two of them, get a feel and a sense for what it is and what it takes to complete those. Even if you have no computer science experience at all, that is the point, especially with Mobile CSP, is to be an intro course. And try computer science for the very first time, you should get a feel like that maybe it's not too intimidating and I can do this. And, you know, that will give you a sense of what you could possibly share and about your experience with educators who might be a good fit to bring the course back to their students, or even when suggesting students sign up and enroll in the courses at your school, it'll give you a better sense.
Okay, thank you. And could a teacher just pull a lesson out of the ebook, or do students need to build on the knowledge from start of the book to the end?
I think both. There are lessons that are definitely are building on content. I think when I think of CSAwesome in particular, that's learning Java, there are definitely are concepts that you need to know before you move on to the harder concepts. If you're looking at a course like Mobile CSP, how I just showed you a App Inventor lesson, a programming lesson. Many of those are tutorials that are step-by-step tutorials. And if you have some understanding of computer science and are comfortable reading or watching and following along with the tutorials, you could possibly pick one that might be later in the course, but I would suggest doing them in the order that they are presented, because we do try to build on skills as they're going through the whole entire curriculum.
Okay, thank you. I'm sorry, did I cut you off?
No.
I want to make sure I did. Okay, very good. Thank you. And can you speak to what it's like being a young person in tech, handling social expectations, possibly being one of very few women, whatever you think educators should know and how they can encourage more young women, gender, queer, non-binary students to explore computer science?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. Speaking from experience, it was definitely when I got into my internship, it was an area that I had no idea what I was getting myself into, so to speak. It was the fact that I was told, there will be people here to support you. There will be people that you will be working with. I knew at the time that another young woman was hired and we were partnered together, and we were right around the same expertise and experience level with computer science, and we were paired together. And I think it was very nice that we kind of gelled well together, and we that helped with our learning experience. We had a lot of fun that summer. So I think just being supportive, being able to share opportunities that you think are fitting for the students. I will say I need to give a shout out to Dr. Ralph Morelli, who is the reason why I'm in computer science and was a part of that internship. I think even with the internship that I had and the experience that I had, I still needed that person. And that for me was Dr. Morelli, who said, this is something that you're good at. This is something that you could turn into more. And I want to see you major in computer science. So I think that belief and that personal relationship that he built with me, again, being supportive and encouraging me to continue on, was definitely what I needed. And without it, I probably would never have even thought that a computer science major was for me, and that I was capable of doing it. So I think being supportive, building relationships, sharing opportunities. And I mentioned my counselor, Mrs. Edwards, who shared an opportunity and encouraged me to go, even though I didn't know what I was getting myself into. So sharing those opportunities and saying, this is why I think it would be a good fit for you to pursue. And if you take that kind of leap of faith and that plunge, I'll be there to support you as you're going through.
Okay, thank you. What are your next plans in regard to your career?
I think I announced already that I had the title change. So that's really was my focus, was to try to make sure that I was building in some way. And so I think right now for me, because that's still so new, I'm in a transition period, and trying to focus on making sure that I'm making that transition smooth and benefiting from that transition. I'm someone who firmly believes in our Benedictine value at CSS of the love of learning. And I think even though I am going through this transition of a title change, I'm trying to embrace that it's a learning opportunity for myself. As was mentioned in my introduction, I'm doing the certificate in project management and still trying to grow in that aspect. So for me right now, it's really focusing on this transition and making a smooth transition into the new position that I have.
Okay, great. And our final question for this evening, what about the future of technology are you excited about? What about the future of technology are you excited about?
I definitely am always excited about the student ideas that come up. I think every year we're coming across new and refreshing ideas that are coming about. I think also there's a lot of talk around AI right now. And even for me, that is an area that I don't have expertise with, that I would love a little bit more hands-on experience and learning more about AI. So I think that that's exciting to see that the younger generation are kind of growing up with AI now, and they're to see what they're going to do with it, you know, 5-10 years from now, I think is going to be amazing to watch. So I'm looking forward to seeing students take advantage of how computer science education is changing.
Okay, thank you so much. Okay, so that is all the questions that we have time for this evening. Again, I want to thank everyone who attended for this evening, and I especially want to thank Pauline for joining us for this evening and sharing your knowledge and your experience and expertise with us. And also, I want to give a big thank you to NCWIT and all of those that are behind the scenes in making sure that this all was possible for this evening. Have a good evening, everyone.